Bung bung. Feeling tired? Fuck that. Perk up and level up with Bung Bung Coffee's delicious modern dark roast. Your favorite brewer's favorite brew. BungBungCoffee.com.
Welcome to the party. Best show on the internet. Ask anybody. You know it's easy money. Sit back, relax, get your headphones, everybody. Welcome to the party. Blackout in the booth. Every episode's a party. We go hard like Ricky Bobby. Tell a friend to tell a friend. This is Welcome to the Party.
How you been, man?
How are you?
Yeah, pretty good. Have you been on the road much lately?
Yeah, so I've been doing the cruise ships.
Oh, yeah.
Been a delight.
Yeah.
And then just trying to gig either in the cities that I'm getting off or getting on.
Yeah.
So like this weekend, got lucky. I disembarked in Auckland and I was able to do the club there, which was phenomenal. So yeah, good times, man.
Yeah, awesome. And are you coming to Adelaide for Fringe?
Yeah, I'll be doing the Fringe. So still working out exactly what I'll be doing as far as like the lineups, but I'll be doing a new hour.
Yeah,
I'll probably put on the show that I did last year because that became a really good show, and I think what I did in Adelaide was like far enough from what it became to not feel bad about doing it again.
Yeah, it's funny, like the expectation sometimes of having a new hour every year, even if like the show's evolved. Sometimes you just got to change the name of it because people think that they've seen it.
Oh yeah,
yeah,
yeah, yeah, yeah, and they probably won't remember all of it.
No chance.
Thematically, there's probably not going to be a sea change every year unless you're like an adventure comic. You're probably still going to be talking about like the parts of your life. So, you know, relationships, family, work.
Yeah.
I don't know, middle age for me, you know? Yeah.
Yeah. And you've been, you do a little bit of acting. I haven't seen anything on Instagram for a while, but I saw you were, I think you were a detective or something in a show.
Oh, yeah. I was a hitman, mate. Yeah.
A hitman, so right.
I did like a short film and I was a hitman, which was really fun.
Yeah.
And got a fire like, well, yeah, proper. I mean, it was deactivated. They'd taken out like the killing bit of the, I just fired blank rounds. That was it.
Yeah.
Exciting. Took me back to my days in the Crips and that was a show, and then I did a horror film and that came out, so we had the premiere for that in August.
That's brand new.
Yeah, that'd be like 2 and a bit years work.
Yeah.
More for the director and production crew, but yeah, pretty big undertaking, and we had the premiere at the Capitol Theatre in Melbourne, so it was like a pretty huge night for me. I've not been like the lead in anything, and in the UK my accent was really viewed as, it's probably softened a lot being out here, but it really made getting acting work problematic, or stuff with dialogue.
Oh really?
yeah, because I think I just used to be like a cloud of sound, but now I'm more discernible.
Yeah, no, I haven't had any problem over the couple of years that I've known you, but there's some people I talk to, I'm just like, what?
Yeah, that's fair enough. How about you, mate? You doing all right?
Oh yeah, man. I've just been like putting on these regional shows, self-producing those, and trying to just trying to book them. It's just, that's the hardest part of it. You know, getting on stage is the easy part, but just getting these shows in a place, selling tickets, you know how it goes. That's the hard part.
Yeah, it's mainly admin. Like the bulk of the job is admin.
Seriously, yeah. Have you done any acting recently? Apart from the stuff that's come out?
I mean, like, I wouldn't say meaningful stuff. I did, the feature in the show, and then I was in a Ladbrokes advert that seemed to air very quickly from the time of recording. Yeah, and that's been it. My acting agent retired, so I need to
set
a new one out so I can get put forward for proper work, I suppose. Because otherwise, it's just me like trawling casting boards and
yeah,
sort of putting in And I feel like some of those things are so AI driven now, like the job suggestions you get.
Yeah.
So I've clearly got like really large human in my description.
Of course.
It's and like... I got smashed with a bunch of, we found a good job for you. And it was for like an airline ad. And very specifically, it said, must not be a massive human.
Yeah, right. So they've just pulled those words out.
Yeah.
They'll, don't make it look as uncomfortable as it really is.
Yeah.
So we're going to talk about Rebel Ridge today.
Yeah, please.
What made you choose Rebel Ridge?
It's just the best film I've seen in ages.
Yeah.
So it was like a lovely throwback to just probably like, it's like a dad's holiday book.
Yeah. It's like the movies a lot of people, especially like if you grew up around like the 90s, late 80s, like the stuff you'd sit down and watch with your dad.
Yeah.
You know, Rambo and all those kind of revenge, or just like one guy against the man or whatever.
Yeah. Righteousness.
Yes.
Against a corrupt system.
Yes, the corruption is the biggest thing here. Yeah.
Yeah. I think one of the first notes I made about it was Black Reacher.
Black Reacher. Yeah. It's very similar to Jack Reacher in that way, except I guess Jack Reacher is a comic book and this is more of a original, if you want to even call it an original. It's obviously been done before, but I still thought it was pretty fresh.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think the references are pretty on the nose. So I rewatched it. Before this, and because some of the dialogue I found goes like really whispery.
Yeah.
And some of the references like around the what would we call it? Inserted video and audio or music are quite subtle but are clearly like nudging the viewer and the plot along. But yeah, one of the songs that came on was like On the Killing Floor or Killing Floor Blues, which is the first Reacher book.
Oh really? Okay, I didn't know that.
But I loved it. That was probably the main reason. I was like, this is like an exciting, perfect, like tight film.
Yeah.
With like a really, small cast, like pretty small ensemble and small in scale, but just tense.
Yeah. And for what, like, I didn't look into the budget and all of that, but it wouldn't have been through the roof. But they managed to do some pretty big stuff with what they had, like pulling the wall down, even creating a fake wall to do that with is no, you know, it's no easy feat. Like, so with the budget that they had, I thought they did some pretty big stunts and pretty big practical effects.
That they made a Ford truck look like the Batmobile.
It was really
bulletproof and really ate a lot of rounds, but he got shot at a lot and kept going.
Yeah.
That was like a good advert. I felt like films like that.
You think Ford pitched in a bit for that one?
Absolutely. Like 100%. I think films like that or TV like that sometimes struggle for product placement. Like,
you should have made it a Westerns. White Bronco.
Yeah, it's hard.
With a black like, man driving away.
They should have had like the Ford music, should have the trailer.
Yeah.
But yeah, the SD cards. And then it's guns, you know. I'm like, what pays for this film?
Yeah.
Outside of Netflix. But yeah.
For the people, I'll just go through the plot real quick. A former Marine grapples his way through a web of small town corruption when an attempt to post bail for his cousin escalates into a violent standoff with the police chief. That the conversation that he has with the police chief outside, where he eventually ends up grabbing his gun and saying, we're not going to do that or whatever. That's really where the action really starts. And that's a significant way into the film, which I thought a lot of these films will get straight into the action. There's no sort of character development, but we got a good idea of the main character and the corruption within the police force in that 25, 30 minutes in the lead up to all the action, I thought.
Yeah, totally.
I was definitely rooting for him. Like a lot of the time I'll be watching some of the movies that are coming out now and I just don't care. I don't care what's going on. They haven't built the character up enough for me to really give a fuck about what the outcome is. But I was really rooting for this guy.
Yeah, I think it tapped into social issues as much as like the caricature dirty cop or like broken sheriff against disavowed veteran.
Yeah.
And I feel like we knew what the film was within 30 seconds. That was it. But I think it's like, oh, bad cops.
Yeah.
Bad cops. He's going to need his money back.
Yeah.
He's a good guy. He's yoked. We'll find that out within about 20 seconds. He's got a hose pipe vein when he's on his push bike.
Yeah.
It's like, sweet, sign me up for 90 minutes of this. Like, I'm aware of some of the beats, but there were so many lovely reveals, I suppose, in like the logic of their corruption and how well the police were like able to like get ahead of the pushback and like nicks, just remove hope from the lady who tries to help them out somewhere. And
the judge, like the judge was in on it, but he didn't want to be. So he was like, he was doing the least corruption. Although he was corrupt, he was doing the least amount of corruption that he could to sort of get this scheme going along. But because of that, there was a pattern in the amount of time that they were putting these, misdemeanor felons away for 90 days. Everyone was 90 days because they didn't want to keep anyone a day longer than they had to be in there for the scheme they were running.
But yeah, everyone was sort of held in this bind, which was, we are small town Bible belts, nothing, no money coming in America. This bloke who's going to be running for sheriff, which is even more power.
Yeah.
Is keeping the town afloat by essentially fleecing outsiders.
Yeah. Why did the cousin die? Did they make that clear? I can't remember.
Yeah. So he got stabbed up in prison.
But was there a reason? Because the main character, sorry, I'm forgetting his name, Terry, played by Aaron Pierre. So he was desperate to get his cousin out. Like it was an urgent. It seems urgent, like he knew something bad was going to happen. Did they kind of go into why that was going to happen? Or
yeah, so he was into bad stuff.
Yeah.
I think he said like out west or out east, basically in their old life.
Oh, yeah. He'd moved into drugs.
Yeah, he'd moved, gotten straight. And then, probably a bit of, bad American policing got caught with a bit of weed on him, all, which is probably didn't happen either. But yeah, and then so I think he maybe turned witness. I think that was it, and it was AI.
Yeah,
you can't go back in.
That's right.
It would have been a second conviction, I think, which is pretty buggering.
Yeah. So this guy, Terry, he's an ex-Marine, and he goes to the courthouse to try and get pay the bail, but he realizes something's going on. He tries to get some information out of the girl. And when that happens, evidence starts to compile and he wants to blow it up and he realizes he's going to have to do it himself and stand up to the corruption and the injustice on a micro level. Right, it's only going to affect this town. It's not going to do anything for the wider country, but he has to do it himself. I'm just wondering, has there ever been a situation that you've been in where there's been an injustice, no matter how big or small, that you've had to stand up to independently?
Yeah, all right.
Yeah.
joke theft.
Oh, so you've been a victim of joke theft before?
So I was working for a company and I was judging a comedy competition. Of like amateurs, and I was part of a panel of professional peers as part of a paid engagement, and one of these amateur competitors just ripped this gig doing jokes that are all of my mates' jokes.
No.
And I was like a couple of cocktails in, right? So my level of righteousness was higher.
Yeah.
And it needed to have been. But I sort of said to him, I went, you recite other people's jokes really well. I went, I don't know how many of them you wrote, but a lot of them were really familiar. And he was like, I wrote all of them, you know, because he ripped. Like, people are like, oh, he's as funny as the pros. He's the champion.
Wow.
And I was like, no, I know the people. Like, and also, I was like, if you're going to steal from people, steal more consistently.
Yeah.
So there was Frankie Boyle in there. There was Dimitri Martin. There was Milton Jones. There was Jimmy Carr. Just pick a voice.
They're too big anyway. Like, obviously, I don't condone stealing from an open micer, but like, these are people that are on Netflix, on TV, that you can see these jokes.
Yeah, I mean, you famously got like a load of promising open micers in your basement, and
That's it. Bottom, I'm working down there. It's like 1,000 monkeys down there.
Yeah.
Eventually, they'll come up with some gold.
But I kicked off. I sort of let the guy have it and was, yeah. So I feel like I did the morally right thing.
You did it directly. Lost
the booking. I've not been back on for that event since.
Now that's fucked up.
And I've spoken to other peers.
Yeah.
Who do that show, and they're like, oh yeah, just let them have it. Just tell them they were really good and move on. Like, there's no, why are you getting on your high horse? It's like, because it's one's right, you know, to protect the IP or highlight that it is hard. Like, not everyone should blaze. Like,
yeah, and it depends on the person that's doing the stealing, of course. If they're enough of a scumbag, you saying something isn't going to do shit anyway. But Once someone knows that it's happening, it'll shake them enough to stop doing it. So, like, I think you've got to let them have it.
Yeah, I mean, you can have a quiet word, but mine was trying to give them a talking to in front of 500 people in a
Okay.
Full transparency. I could have handled it more diplomatically.
I don't know. Name and shame, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. String them up.
But I reckon he's doing really well on the after dinner circuit now.
So. Okay. Well, good for him. The thought that came to my mind with that question was, comedy's an industry where we're pretty forgiving with payment. You know, if you get a plumber to your house and they do a job, they get paid. Whereas we stick around for weeks, sometimes months, sometimes many months before we get the money for a gig that we've done. And you know, I've never burnt a bridge per se in terms of that. I've talked to a couple of people about it and been like, hey, look, like, I worked for you. Tickets were sold. You got the money. So I expect my money. I shouldn't be waiting this long. I get it for a festival when there's, you know, a month before settlement and then the money comes in. But if it's just a gig that you sold tickets for and people bought tickets, I know you got the money. So give me my money.
Yeah, that all feels very logical. So how have you dealt with that?
I try to do the professional follow-up email and then I slowly get more and more frequent until a phone call starts or, you know, I've seen people call people out on Facebook, but you don't want to be publicly, in my opinion, you know, you don't want to be publicly seen to be that guy because then it's like, oh, this guy could be a problem. I'm just not going to book him because he'll post something on Facebook if I can't pay him on time or whatever. So, I haven't gone to that level yet.
But that's interesting. That's industry forces. You've got like market power and buyer power and supplier power. There is a showrunner and producer from the UK who famously was like really hard to get money out of. And then basically they just became like a critical mass of comics who were like, no, this can't stand.
Yeah.
And then enough people were like, We'll call them out publicly. We'll not work for them. We'll have a go at people who do work for them, because that's the thing. It's a mercenary industry. And if you don't want to go and collect the bag, someone else will.
Exactly.
With someone after
there's always going to be someone out there that wants the stage time, wants the paycheck.
Yeah.
And that's where it gets a bit dicey, because you know, you've probably heard people talk about like unionizing comedy.
Yeah.
And there should be a minimum amount of payment for, you know, this much time on stage or whatever. But there's always going to be, you know, some open micer that wants to get paid more quickly than maybe they should. And they'll be like, hey, I'll do 15 minutes for $20.
Yeah, yeah, that's it. Or just pay me whenever you want. You know, they'll waive terms or they'll waive fee because you want stage time. Or they'll offer more. They'll be like, oh, well, I'll drive everybody. Or something like that, because they want the progression. They want to build a relationship. And that's part of, it's a very prospecty industry. Like, you're doing great with this podcast. You're going.
Anything creative, really.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a million examples, I guess, but I just wanted to see if you had something. But I like that one. I like that. You're like Simon Cowell at this fucking.
No, I really got righteous. I was full like Gandalf, like know your place.
I love that. I fucking love that so much.
Yeah. I've definitely lost a bit. So hopefully, I can grease the wheels and get back in, and just be more diplomatic about it, because I spoke to him. I tried to speak to him about it in the bar. Later on, so we're in the same venue, and he was like, oh, I've never gigged before, that was my first gig, and I went, you might be the greatest comedian of all time.
Yeah.
I was like, you might have come up with all of those jokes organically, and you might be a genius.
Yeah.
But I was like, I don't think you are, but I might be wrong. And anyway, and then his wife came over and really started letting me have it, and she's like, who are you to say that to my bloke?
Feel like Jason Tatum's mom.
Yeah. She's the real MVP.
Yeah.
Everyone's mom. And really let me have it. Who do you think you are? And I went, I'm an effing comedian.
Yeah.
That's who I am. Like, it's all incumbent on all of us to protect the industry. And I was like, if he's going to do that, stick to after dinner and footy clubs and rugby clubs. But he should not present himself as a stand-up. I was like, he's an after dinner speaker.
Yeah. Yeah, because
it's not a bad gig.
It's all those jokes, someone had to go out every night to, you know, it started with an idea that didn't work, and then it worked, and then it got better and better and better, and it took a long time, and then this guy just goes up first time on stage and presents it as his own work, and it's
just nuggets.
Yeah.
He's just got Uber Eats from all of these five-star restaurants.
Yeah.
And he's just plating it as his canapes.
Yeah. No, it's not. It's not fair. It's like there's like a certain level of loyalty you've got to have for your peers, I think. Almost like Terry had loyalty for his cousin. At first it was to get him out of his pay bail, get him out of jail. And then there was a revenge aspect following that. I've got like I said before, the regional gigs I've been doing them with the same crew for the most part, because I know that they're loyal. I know that they're going to understand, you know, this is the setup we've got. You know, I'm expecting 100 ticket sales. If we get 20, I'm going to have to pay you less, okay? And they understand that. Yeah, so. Yeah, I think that loyalty is also important in what we do.
Well, that was another thing that I loved about it. So firstly, amazing segue. That was great. But yeah, just it, well, yeah, the I've just finished playing Red Dead Redemption 2, and like Western themes through the film I thought were really beautiful. Like a real man's gotta have a code.
Yeah.
Stuff about it, and he didn't want more. Like, he went into, you know, the back room, and he could have bought a small island,
yeah,
and liberated it with the arsenal they had. He was like, I just want my bag of money.
Yeah,
he even offered them a deal. Like, he tried to broker a peaceful arrangement, and the ego of the mad king, the broken sheriff, wouldn't allow it, because he couldn't be seen to cowtail to this outsider. all of those things were beautiful. So I mean, yeah, have you had that with any of your gang, if you're like leading the gang, if you've had to tell them like, look, lads, we only sold 30 tonight, so we're on the off-brand beers.
We've probably one show, which was a bit of a trek, and the venue owner wasn't as generous as some others have been. So we had to like, yeah, he got a bit funny about giving us dinner and stuff. So we bought dinner and drinks for the whole night. We didn't get any rider, and we sold less tickets than expected. So by the time I paid the guys and they'd also bought dinner and drinks, they really weren't making a lot of profit.
Yeah, everyone's breaking even.
Yeah, but they were pretty understanding of that, and that's why you make sure you got good people around you. You don't like it's hard to I won't name names here, but you talk to somebody who may start talking shit about another gig or someone else's gig. And then when you're running your own shit, it's like, well, if I have you on and maybe it's a bad night, do you then go and spread shit about my show? So
Yeah.
now I can't really trust you to have me on. I can't trust you to have to come on my show in case, in case something does go wrong, or
Yeah.
we don't get enough people in, or.
And I think this might be a thing that I think people who've got normal jobs might have a hard time with. I'm going to do a bit of inside baseball thing, which is like the gig maths,
Yeah.
right? Which is everyone's done it, we've all done it, where like you arrive at a gig, there's, let's say they've sold 100 seats, 30 ahead. You know, the venue's taking the bar, so they've got no overhead. Yeah, how am I only getting 200 for this, or
Yeah.
whatever it is, do you know what I mean? Because you only see the expense that you're really exposed to.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You're not aware of, oh well, he's been building his network for 10 years, and he's pay flyer as and artwork, and his website and all the Facebook ads. I just feel like that can be like quite a toxic thing. But hopefully, with your initiative, you'll find the right town and you'll sell a few hundred.
Yeah.
Oh, great.
It's the
Yeah.
same with I used to have a job where I billed hourly,
Yeah.
and I'd be like, I'd bill X amount per day, and you'd see, okay, so over the course of however many days I work per year, I bring in this much money. Holy shit, I'm only getting paid this much. But like, yeah, I've got no risk. It's not my company. I'm not paying marketing. I'm not paying salaries. I'm not paying clean. Like, there's so much more to that, like just what you're bringing into the building.
Yeah, it
Yeah.
feels like a Spike Lee bit of dialogue. Like, you don't understand the
Yeah.
overheads.
But like you said, with the Western thing, like the scene I spoke of earlier with the two sort of facing off in front of the,
Oh, yeah.
yeah, it was like very. I didn't think of it at the time, but it was very like a Clint Eastwood, like Fistful of Dollars moment, like the
Oh,
close-ups.
yeah, that and the way they. Well, yeah, the framing, I think that's probably the term. I sequenced it for, they were on about him, and then he does, yeah, he rides in.
Yeah, he stands out the front solo.
Yeah, and beautiful in the way that he presents himself. He's like, I'm unarmed, hands covered, so I'm not a threat.
Yeah.
You know, basically going, you can't shoot me. You can't, there's no way you can like do that. But the way that he breaks the space
Yeah.
is so wonderful, just as they're working out that he's an absolute menace,
Yeah.
because they'd had the dialogue saying that he's yeah, that he hadn't served in active duty,
Yeah.
but it was
I thought
basically just because of him.
I think that was my favorite scene of the whole film. Like that, just that it just kicked everything off. Obviously, there was the big action scene as well,
Yeah.
which was a lot of fun. But I think that initial dialogue, and he's talking about the acronyms, and he walks him through. I forget what the acronym was, but he walks it through. Like, this is like, you're leaving me with this letter. Do you know what this letter is? And
Yeah,
yeah,
it was
oh,
great. It's the acronym was PACE, and he's like,
pace.
"Well,
That's
that's where
right.
we arrive."
Yeah.
All I got left is E.
The acronym you need to worry about right now is PACE. PACE. Ever heard of it? It's a planning methodology used for comm systems, but they found it could be applied anywhere. Nursing, engineering, parachute infiltrations, posting bail. So the P is for primary. That's me riding into town with my bag of money. A is for alternate. That's a deal we apparently never made. C is my contingency. That's the restaurant owner you put out of business this morning. And there it is. Spot on too, like you just ate shit. Anyway, you got me burning through all these letters. And after this conversation, we already on E. You know what that stands for?
Marine Corps Martial Arts Program.
What?
MCMAP. Combat system combines hand-to-hand, close quarters. Oh. I think he's on the Wikipedia page. Teaching jujitsu to the 6th Marine Regiment.
Okay.
It's team building. One mine, any weapon.
Calling any units on patrol.
Yep.
Here come your peeps.
Chief!
You want to honor that deal or do I got to transition to
E? Put some distance between you.
Let's not do that.
Yeah, it was amazing. And Don Johnson's so great.
Yeah.
Just, yeah, the bit about, yeah, the shit-eating grin. So his dialogue was beautiful.
Yeah.
Because he had a bit of an arc. I don't know the guy's name, but I love him, the bloke who was in the office in Brightburn. The big copper.
Oh, yes. Roy from The Office. Yeah, I forget his real name.
Yeah, he's amazing. Because he's got an arc, because you're like, oh, God, this guy's just going to be like another big piece of shit.
Yeah.
I love it in films where they deploy... I think, yeah, because sports. I love it when people are able to go, yeah, 6'4", 250. I just like when people can frame people like that.
Yeah. And he's definitely, he's one of those guys.
But that, yeah, that scene. And then the choreography, when he then did his like clear, almost like he was doing a training drill. He was so, his performance as a action actor, when he just sort of moved through the two baddies.
Yeah.
Really like, and then I take this person down and then I disarm him by doing that. Don't do that.
Yeah. It's funny because he was a military martial arts training
person.
So yeah, he'd never seen active duty, but he was, like you said, it was like a drill. These guys do this, I do this.
Yeah. And
it was just completely flawless, everything he did. Even in the gunfire and stuff, he was so cool, calm, collected.
Well, yeah, there's like a bit at the end, up towards the end, where it's all, you know, the fire's going and it's all kicking off. And he's just so calm. And he says to somebody, he's like, okay, what do we do now? We evac. And he's just like running through his training.
Yeah.
EMA theory of like, what's our process map?
Yeah.
And it was so beautiful. There was no panic. There was no like hands on hips, Captain America stuff. It was just like, I'm trained. I'm ready for the moment. I follow the plan.
Yeah. And there was a part, I can't remember where it was. It might've been when he first got apprehended in the courthouse, where she was like, what are you going to do now? He's like, I didn't plan this far or something.
And then,
so he had to wait. He had to get apprehended and then sort of, reevaluate later, which was good, because it's probably more realistic that way than just like being invincible for the whole thing, even though he got tased and just pulled the taser out or whatever.
There were some like great some amazing scenes. That's like the best anyone's ever been tased in a movie. I wonder if it actually qualifies as a sports movie. There's an awful lot of cycling.
Oh yeah, there was a lot of cycling.
It's the most thing that I've been watching cycling since Icarus.
Pretty sturdy bike. To get hit by a car and then he can still ride off after that was pretty amazing.
That was incredible. I got hit like that on my bike when I was in London.
Oh shit.
And the back wheel was bent in such a way my bike like hopped.
Yeah.
When it would go around because it was such a dip. But sports movie. I thought the lady who played let's stay on that really. So he was amazing, the bloke with Terry. So his righteousness curve, there was never like he was never excessive. The bit when he used the salt bags or whatever they're called, the bean bags. It's like he knows exactly what's going to happen. He's totally, he's like, of course they're going to flip and try to kill me, so I've got to put them down safely. And
And that's what, and he says it to the black lady in the, she's the one that like gets the bag of money and stuff for him, because he thinks that she's the friend on the inside. I won't spoil that part, but he says, if you follow my instructions, we can get through this without anybody dying. And that moment didn't trigger for me that they were actually going to do it. I just figured that they weren't going to follow the rules and people were going to die. But we went through a huge, huge action movie with no deaths.
Well, I mean, what?
Or the brother, the cousin. Yeah, but we didn't see that. There was no there was no gruesome, gunshots, stabbings. It was all like, I'm just gonna disarm this person and disable them or whatever. He snapped a guy's arm, which was pretty cool.
Oh, great.
But
Great
yeah, he
movie.
didn't kill anyone. So I thought that was an interesting way to do it, because I don't know what the rating was on it. I'll just have a quick look. Yeah, it was MA, so I mean they could have.
Yeah, not a lot of cursing. He was very proper. And that meant that when he did swear, it really had power.
Yes. Which is again bringing it back to comedy. Like if you're just swearing every 5 seconds, it's like, well, why is he
It's
doing
easy
this?
to
But
know.
like if you only swear when it's going to add something, it changes, yeah, the power, the meaning of the words that you're saying.
But yeah, he had a great arc. I loved the ladies. Or Summer, because she's such like a field mouse
Yeah.
at the start, and then she has two great lines. She has a go at like the I don't know what you'd call them, like the courtroom clerk or the main attendant.
Yeah.
Like, you're a tumor. Oh,
Oh yeah.
flipping heck.
Was that when
And
they were at
then
they went outside, like they were at the church or something, and they went outside and he wouldn't talk, he wouldn't give the information.
He was like the first person they tried to rumble. They were like, yeah, I suppose, what would that be? Not the third act, yeah, probably middle act. Yeah, where they bring him out, they isolate him away from the herd and try to talk to him. And then when she's speaking to the judge, and he tries to play like the old man card, and he's like, oh, you wouldn't want. What would Mary do seeing you like this? And she's like, if she knew what you'd done, she'd want to watch.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah,
Yeah, I
she'd
love
want to
that
hold you
line.
down.
Yeah. I was watching it in bed, in my headphones while my partner was asleep, and that bit I wanted to be like, fuck yes. Like yeah, she was really good. I don't really remember her from anything, but she was fantastic.
So I feel like everyone, yeah, they all smashed it.
Yeah.
But yeah, he's dead good. He's been cast as like
Green
a Green
Lantern.
Lantern in the new TV thing. So
He was always, after this, he was always going to get something, because he smashed it. He was unreal.
yeah, and then well, I feel like it just sets up more like you don't want to call them identikit holiday action romps in like a very safe way, because that was great. That up the arm scene. I love a bit of gratuitous violence in films.
Oh yeah. Oh, I've got a good one for you. I don't, you might have seen it, but Brawl in Cell Block 99.
I've not seen it, but I will watch it now.
It's Vince Vaughn.
I've heard
Like
about
you've never
it.
seen it. Yeah, it is the most violent movie I've ever watched. And some of it's like clearly a practical effect. Like there's this one scene that he stomps this guy's head into the concrete floor and scrapes his foot along the ground, but you can see like it's a dummy.
Yeah, you
It's
can see
not
like the Made in China on
yeah,
it from the loom.
it's not supposed to be funny, like it's supposed to be gross, but like I think they also didn't want it to be too realistic
Well,
because
that may
it's
help.
so intense.
Yeah, cushion the trauma. Yeah.
But it's a good one if you want to
Good,
see some
definitely.
violence at some stage. Next time you see someone steal some jokes, go home and watch that. And
Yeah, I'll just send them a GIF. from that. You know, just clip a little bit. Yeah, because my lass, she gets really affected by what we watch. And I was like, look, right now, I need us to go back and watch like the end of Rebel Ridge because we've not finished it. And yeah, and that arm scene. And I was immediately like, he's been disarmed. That can't help making like one-liners during films. Probably problematic to watch.
Yeah. The sense of relief in the car chase scene where the 10 code comes in and he's like, what does that mean? And they're like, escort. And it's I just thought some of the techniques that they used were just fantastic in the story, in the dialogue, and just I just felt really good about this movie. Knowing that I've talked a lot of shit about Netflix originals, they knocked this one out of the park.
Yeah, I think I love watching those an expert rates where they'll have like a Marine Sniper will deconstruct sniper scenes in movies.
Oh, okay, yep.
So I'd like our martial arts expert does Scott Adkins breaks down his fight scenes. I'd love to watch one about that because there's so much cop stuff, like the bit where they drive by and they do that, and then they're on doing the codes, and when they breach and all that, and the scene like in front. So the scene you're on about, where there were the two, I don't know what they were, whether they were like extra police officers or just.
I have a feeling. I don't think they made that clear, but I have a feeling they may have been like state troopers that weren't part of the actual police department of that town.
Yeah, right. And like a military expert just for basically to deconstruct Terry's decision making and
That'd be fun.
If you
see any of that, send me the link because that'd be a great watch, I think.
Yeah. But yeah, that was palpable, that sort of wind down. Because yeah, she was like, what does that mean?
Yeah.
Well, it means that he's safe. They've made a decision where that copper's life is more valuable than them all dying.
Yeah.
I think there might have been like either a come to Jesus moment, or they thought having to pay his family off for like the millions or whatever it is to pay for an officer who gets killed in duty and stuff like that.
And just the that black police officer, there was a reason that he thought that she was the inside person. Like he could feel that she knew something wasn't right, but she was kind of going along with it. And then right at that last moment, she she fishtails the cop car and gives him like a free run. So she made the right decision right at the end,
she's just at the bottom of the pecking order as well.
Yeah.
He identifies that dead early, isn't it? It's like they sent you off, like put you under the desk to hide. You get the shit car.
Yeah, mention that. That's right. Yeah.
But yeah. I wonder whether that's probably like another thing that they'd speak about like penetrating a gang or infiltrating a mob. Like you look for the person who the Freddo of the group, might be able to turn.
Who might be doing the gig maths, you know? They're like, look at how much Tony's getting paid. I'm here fucking sending emails. Like, yeah, they're making me ride around in the shit car and so all of a sudden someone comes in and makes you a CI.
But yeah, that was an amazing scene. Because that harked back to the scene earlier where they ride him out of town, which was like big Western energy, where they sort of followed him in the car behind up to basically like the city limits.
City limits, yeah. And then did a U-turn as he drove up.
And just the menace. So many great scenes of menace and fear, like the bit where where they go in and drug it and just they do that. But then they've also, if she...
You stick the magnet on the fridge.
Yeah. But like it's like if she somehow survives, she's got to go into work the next day. We've arranged it to where she's going to get tested. Would blow her whole life up.
Yeah.
Or they've just automatically blown her life up and what's it called? Discredited her as a human.
Yeah. Specifically as a mother.
Yeah.
Yeah. Grimy shit.
Oh.
But yeah, just like I love a badass that just takes everything into his own hands, like a John Wick. I just love all those type of movies, man. And that's Aaron Pierre, I think he was flawless, really.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely excelled.
Have you ever done any like vigilante missions?
In life?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, everyone's dead now, so I'll probably talk about it. It was when I was in Russia. Yeah, that president's dead. Anyway, but the... No. I'm a man of peace now, and I don't have a dog. But once I find the bastards who killed it...
Yeah. It's over.
Have I? That is a great question. Have I done any vigilante antics? Joke theft, I really went for them.
Yeah.
Who's wronged me? Who's had it? Oh, yeah, right. Here's one.
Yeah.
So, yeah, this is probably a bit like Terry. I'm really going to big up my decision making here. Yeah, so when I got hit from behind on my bicycle, I got hit into the back of a cab.
Okay. Right?
The car hit me, drove off. That's the dodgy person. The cab driver comes up and he's straight standing over me like, "Right, what have you done? You owe me money for
this dinging
up the back of his cab."
Yeah.
And I was like, "Look, man, I clearly got hit." And I was like, "Let's work together. I'll try to really abridge this." But basically, I tried to work with him to get the other person. Couldn't get the other person.
You're Terry, the cab driver, Summer.
Initially.
Okay.
And then Terry, this is quite confusing because the cab driver was also called Terry.
Okay.
Terry, the cab driver, becomes Don Johnson, crooked cop.
Oh, okay.
Because I say to him, I go, "Look, man, we can't get hold of this third party driver." And he's like, "You hit me. You are me, Manny." And starts coming after me. We'd previously been quite pally. So I was like, "Look, man, I'm a comedian. Do you know what I mean? Like, let's hang out."
Yeah.
And then he just becomes like a menace because he can just Google me and find out where I am. So he starts playing up with gigs and stuff, threatening voice messages because he's just trying to squeeze me for money. And I was like recording all of the voice messages. And it got away. I got a bit worried for my life. So I spoke to the police, who were good in this instance. And they were like, "Look, if we go and give him a warning, he'll lose his license."
You're like the fucking guy from Baby Reindeer. Yeah. Except, no, I'd probably rather get hit by a car, to be honest. But
yeah, I feel like what Richard went through was incredibly traumatic. And yes. I was basically just being like, I was dealing with a fear monger, basically.
Yeah.
But yeah, they said, "Oh, if we're threatening him, if we're going, not threatening him, if we go and have a word with him, he'll lose his license." And I said, "Don't do that, because that will lead to him going absolutely mental."
Mm.
He rings me up and he's like, "I know you're a tonight," which was like dead near where I lived. And so I like took a weird route and stuff. And he's waiting in the doorway of the gig. And he pulls out a court order that it looked like he'd done on his computer at home.
He's like,
"Court and I what?" And I go, "All right." And he goes, "I'll come to all of your gigs and I'll hold this up." And I go, "Look, man, like, a lot of my gigs are out of town. You're only after about $1,000 off me. You'll be losing a night's work and petrol money."
Yeah.
I was like, you'll have broken even after a month. And then I go into the gig and I tell him, I go, "Oh, look, there's this bloke. He was trying to scare me into giving him money." And the guy at the gig goes, "What you want to do is have him kick off and we'll have the bouncers take him outside and beat him up."
Yeah.
And I was like, when did I walk into a Guy Ritchie film?
Yeah.
It really boosts their East End credentials.
Yeah.
And because I'd logged it with the police beforehand, I'd rang them up and I said, "Look, this guy, he said he might turn up. I just want it logged just in case anything kicks off. Because if it does, then it's clearly premeditated."
Yeah.
And then I get a call from them the next day. He doesn't come into the gig, nothing happens. I get a call from the police the next day, and the police officer answers, and he opens the call, and he goes, did it kick off? And I go, no. And he goes, he sounds disappointed. Sounds like he had money on it.
Yeah.
It was dead funny. He'd gone, because he was trying to get his head around the thing.
Yeah.
And he goes, how big is he? And I go, oh, he's about 5'10". If you just like imagine a sort of mid-40s cab driver, it's that.
Yeah.
And not in great nick, probably racist. And then he goes, and how big are you? And I go, I'm 6'7". And he goes, well. As if my reach was over the car.
What type of matchup is that?
Yeah, it was amazing.
Yeah. Just that's what the, you said that was what the cop said?
Yeah, that's what the cop, I said. Yeah, wow. Yeah, well. And then, so what happened was it kept building, he'd keep on popping up. And then I got sick of it. So really my vigilantism, loosely, is I got sick of being scared, right? And so when he ran, I just sort of had it with him. And I was like, look, man, you need to have a think about what you're doing and what you've done. I was like, I need you to know that I've been recording all of these voice messages. So I've got all of your threats going back quite a way on record. You also produced a fraudulent court order, which is worse than anything.
Yeah.
So they thought that's high criminal stuff. And I said, and the police want to take your license away or coming at me, right? So I was like, you need to have a thing and back down. And trying to think how he threatened me at the end. I think he just quoted Blondie again. He said, I'm going to find you, I'm going to get you. And I was like, have you not listened to the fact that I just said I'm recording these calls? And
yeah.
You can't threaten a sentient adult. Yeah, and then he went away. And then I didn't hear about him until tax time the next year. It was mad.
So he just went away in the end? He said
he just went away. I mean, he might have.
And then what happened at tax time? Just another threat?
He just needed money. So I think he just tried to put the squeeze on again to see if I'd relent.
Fucking hell.
But yeah, it was bad. Like, yeah, it ran for two, three years. Yeah, pretty scary. Because London cabs, the black cabs, they're everywhere, right?
Yeah.
So that's like an odd car to develop a Pavlovian.
Oh, yes. Yeah, so you've just got like a little trauma response to...
Whenever I'd see that silhouette, yeah.
Oh, God. Do you still have it when you go home?
I mean, I've not been home for years. That might be why.
Oh, but, okay. Like,
No, it's pretty good. I can't remember his registration now. I remember his full name. I won't put him on blast.
Terry.
But yeah.
We're coming for you, Terry.
Yeah. I might start putting gigs on around where... I remember I'm living.
Yeah.
like the ultimate, just thumbing my chin.
Yeah. Headline him. So you've got your face up all around his town.
Yeah. And the first show I did that show. Or I talked about that in a funnier way. Sorry, I tried to keep it really short. And
that's
like,
all right.
Neat thing. And yeah, the artwork was like me standing on top of a cab, like an action hero.
That's good.
Yeah, but it's pretty bonkers.
Yeah.
But the police were great. The police were dead nice. And
oh, that's great.
Really helpful. But yeah, they probably would have benefited from getting a collar, like bringing in somebody, you know. But they were like, oh, we won't if you don't want to. And
yeah. The exact opposite of the cops in Rebel Ridge.
Yeah. Yeah.
What would you give Rebel Ridge out of 10?
For what it is. I want to give it a 9 out of 10, because you know exactly what it is within 10 seconds. There's and then you're on that journey. It's throwback action hero stuff.
Yeah.
And it's also not super bloody. So you go, it's a safe Thanksgiving movie. I could put this on with Nana in the room.
Yeah, you actually can. Yeah.
And there's not loads of effing and jeffing.
No.
But lots of stuff happens. And it was a fun rewatch because I put the subtitles on.
Yeah.
So I've caught the music, the song titles that I didn't know, and the bits of telly.
Yeah.
It's funny. There's a bit where just after she's found out she's been needled and he saved her. And the next scene is him going, it's the TV going, the proof's right there.
Oh, My scale is slightly different to yours. Mine is based on every film, not just.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so mine, so, but still great score, 7.5.
Yeah, if I were to put it against all cinema,
yeah,
probably around 7, 7.5. It's no June 2. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, I haven't seen June 2, but I do need to get onto that. But is there anything that you'd like to plug for the moment before you take off?
I mean, yeah, come and see me in Adelaide during the Fringe if you can. And give me a follow, Luke Benson Comedy, on Instagram. That would be brilliant.
Perfect. And what was the name of the horror film?
Oh, Residents. Yeah, Residents. Probably part of me. Yeah. And if they want to see the short, it's called Bin Man. It's on our YouTube channel. So you've got like Luke Benson, Bin Man.
Awesome. Oh, I might have to go and have a look at that and give it a rating. I'll give that one a 10.
Thanks, dude.